Can't everybody stop for 10 minutes? I mean, everybody seems that that's the only... Everybody, can we stick... I mean, it's not that much to ask. Is that when everybody has to move, when I'm trying to concentrate? I mean, that's so rude, I can't believe it. Why does everyone all of a sudden have to move? That 2 hours to move around. Wait 10 minutes. I'm sorry to explode by that, but that's... It's like no one's ever worked before. I actually can't believe what I just saw.
Radio guys who don't have time for the facts.
I hear a dial tone. And there were seven people, though. I mean, we need to use the studio for 15 minutes.
You guys are off to a great start, don't you think?
Hey, buddy, I'm not paying you to hear your thoughts on life.
Well, I have a microphone, and you don't.
So you will listen to every word I have to say!
I know that you do some terrible, terrible things, and I can prove that you do these terrible things, and sure enough, contained in the package was stuff to prove that I do terrible things.
Excuse me, is that your nose or did a bus park on your face?
I just love the way you talk.
Hail to the king, baby.
Don't call me stupid.
Oh, right! To call you stupid would be an insult to stupid people!
Victory is mine!
Got news for you, dude.
I'll use small words so that you'll be sure to understand, you warthog-faced buffoon.
The guilty pleasure offered by the existence of the sideshow Bob is simple and understandable. 99 times out of 100, nearly every time we partake of the movable falafel feast, he serves us nothing but comedy. Farce, slapstick, unconscious self-mutilation, the Sisyphus of morons, if you will. But this is the 100th time out of 100. It is not funny at all. That's on the record and documented. Americans, who deserves better than the sideshow Bob of commentators, we all do.
Well, I think you folks have a real fine show, and it's going to be successful just as soon as people find out what time it's on.
Oh, they're terrible. They're so terrible.
Do you want them to run through it again?
No. No, let's just move on. We have a lot to do.
All right, here we go. Here we go. Are you ready? Are you ready? Let's get it on. Come on.
Do you understand the words that are coming out of my mouth?
Terrible.
What are you doing to me? You'll miss the opening. This is the most important number in the show.
This show's broken, has not even begun yet.
Good.
This show's unairable.
It's the Joel Oriend Show.
Jeez, I can hardly wait.
Today's worst person in the world.
Joel, I love you, and please behave yourself. Now, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome my son, Joel Oriend.
You know what I just heard recently? Probably going to make some people at least throw up in their mouth. Not this show, although this show might have that effect on you as well. But I've heard, and it feels crazy even talking about this because school essentially just got over for high school, college a little while ago. But I just saw on 60 Minutes that UNC is going to open back up. In the fall, like normal, or not completely like normal, but with some changes. And it will give kids a choice to do remote learning, but they will open it up, and obviously they'll have some, you know, health rules and regulations and social distancing rules. And then I just heard yesterday Buff State is going to open up their campuses. Tanner, and again, if you're a teacher or a kid, you got to be like, oh, what are we talking about? School coming back in, we just got out of it. But hey, Tanner, you go to CCC. Have you heard anything about what's going to happen in the fall for you guys?
Nope, I have not heard anything yet. My guess would be is they're going to continue to do remote learning mostly. Personally, I am against that 100%. I cannot stand remote learning. It is the bane of my existence, and it has been every time that I've tried it. So I would prefer to be on campus, actually in a classroom, but I have a feeling that they're not going to just go gung-ho and send everyone right back into the classrooms right off the bat. So we'll probably see a lot of remote learning still.
And, you know, there are campuses. I mean, there are residence halls, right, for CCC. It's not all commuter, but at a community college, there's more commuters, right, that live off campus. So I think at a community college, it's easier maybe to come back than a campus where you have tons of, you know, dorms and halls like that where, you know, everybody is right on that campus. So it'll be interesting to see. I mean, it seems like we've turned the corner. I mean, I'm hearing movie theaters opening up, nationwide chains, making you wear a mask. I just heard we're in phase four. Now that sounds good, but I guess what I don't attend, or do you know how many phases is there? Because if there's like 500 phases, then we're not doing so well. But I mean, phase four sounds pretty good compared to when we were in phase one. It feels like we're moving quickly through the phases. So I guess that's a good thing. I mean, it seems like we've kind of turned a corner. You know, the governor is, you know, he did his last weekly press conference. And, so we'll see. I'm hoping that, you know, maybe things are going to go back to normal and we're going to have fall sports and school, and we'll see. I know they think there's going to be a resurgence, in the fall, but it does seem like things maybe getting back to normal. And I did want, now we talked a little bit last week, Tanner, any, special plans? What do you got planned for your old pops this weekend and for Father's Day?
Well, you know what? Under any normal circumstances, we'd probably go get some Taco Bell together, because that's become almost like a tradition. I mean, every Friday, or close to every Friday, you know, when he was at work and I was at school, we'd meet each other for lunch at Taco Bell. So that would be the ideal plan. But obviously now we can't do that, so I might just have to settle for the drive-through. But we're going to incorporate Taco Bell somehow, you best believe.
Let's see if what you want to give your dad or do with your dad is on the list. So there was a survey done, a new survey of 2,000 Americans conducted by Omaha Steaks finds that these are the things. Now, I'm assuming that's 2,000 dads that they've asked. So I'm just going to go on that premise of what they want for Father's Day. So here we go. Number 11, a cheaper practical gift, socks, tools, etc. 10, sports, back on TV. 9, to sleep in. 8, to be left alone. let's see. Show me how much you love me by leaving me alone and don't talk to me. let's see. Number 7, watch whatever he wants on TV. 6, an expensive gift, tech, smartphone, etc. 5, peace and quiet. 4, phone call from his family. 3, glass of whiskey. 2, I'd go glass of whiskey first, then take the phone call from the family. 2, steak dinner. And 1, an ice cold beer. So get him a cerveza when you go to Taco Bell, my friend.
Oh no, there's definitely a couple on there that I think, now thinking about it, that he would enjoy. Definitely, probably the sleeping in. Definitely the beer, number one. A phone call from his mother, probably, I would assume. One thing that wasn't on there that I just thought of while you were reading that is help doing projects around the house, because that's normally what we do. That's how we spend a lot of time together. So probably have me mow the lawn or clean the gutters or do something on Sunday. I'm surprised that wasn't on there.
Yeah, we'll see. You know, mine is changed a little bit. Normally, mine is, you know, sleep in, leave me alone for most of the day. But then, ice cream, and not in this exact order, ice cream and miniature golf. Because I am the Tiger Woods of miniature golf. Like, I'm like really good. So, I'm really good because I'm allowed to move the ball wherever I want it to, and I get, you know, mulligans whenever I want them and stuff like that. And they know I have to win or I throw a fit and I don't talk the rest of the day. So that's normally what we do. but my wife's like, that can't feel rewarding that, like, people let you win because you're going to get mad. I'm like, yeah, it is, because I won. Who cares? Winning is winning, man. I mean, whether it's playing video games or whatever, if somebody wants to lay down and let me win, then I am going to walk right through that door and Win and sing my song. Daddy done won again. Daddy done won again. And so that's my son's least favorite song of all time. Because he's heard that now for 17 years. Speaking of winning, it does seem like we are winning the battle against COVID-19. Places are opening up. We're in phase 4. So it's very exciting. And Tanner, Google this for me. I don't know if this is something that's actually happening, or if this is like an urban legend, or someone was goofing on me, or it's just a rumor. But somebody told me that there's a national take your mask off, or national don't wear your mask day. So I don't know if that's a real thing or not.
Looks like no mask day is indeed a thing. It's actually today. Oh. June 20th is National No Mask Day.
Wow. Well, listen, it's the first time I'm in vogue because in fashionable because I'm not wearing a mask, ironically. So there you go. No mask day today. You know, I'll leave it up to you if you want to celebrate that. That's your own call. But there you go. No mask day. I'm going to play you a clip of this song. And as you're listening to it, I want you to tell me what it makes you think of. So there's, again, lists, right? Because that's all you basically do these days is do lists. So there's a new list out, and this is 10th on the list. This is supposed to make you feel a certain way.
Never gonna give you up. Never gonna let you down. Never gonna run around.
Okay, what mood, what feelings does that song evoke from you, Tanner?
I mean, it's got more of a lighthearted sound to it, so that's good. But when you first popped that on, it made me think of, like, the 80s. So, like, all these big wig hairdo type bands and spandex and stuff. So I wasn't around back then, but that's just the first thing that came to mind. But, you know, with that up-tempo and lighthearted sounding production, it does give you that kind of good feeling.
All right. Well,
say that.
Well, you're kind of on it. So here you go. A new survey of 1,300 adults ranging in age from 30 to 55. So obviously a little bit older of a crowd than you. Okay. Were asked this question. What song makes you happy? Okay, it makes you feel happy. And that was number 10. All right, so we'll go through the list quickly. Number 20, That's the Way I Like It, KC and the Sunshine Band. Number 19, December 1963, Oh What a Night. Number 18, Flashdance, What a Feeling, Irene Cara. Number 17, Crocodile Rock, Elton John. Number 16, Good Times, Chick. Number 15, You're the Only One That I Want, John Travolta and Olivia Newton-John. Number 14, Livin' La Vida Loca, Ricky Martin. Number 13, You Make Me Feel Mighty Real by Sylvester. 12, Girls Just Want to Have Fun, Cyndi Lauper. 11, Wake Up Boo, The Boo Radleys. Number 10, Never Gonna Give You Up, as we just played. Number 9, Just Can't Get Enough, Depeche Mode. Number 8, Walking on Sunshine, Karina and the Waves. Number 7, You Can Call Me Al, Paul Simon. Again, these are the happiest songs in the world, according to this survey. Number 6, Come On Eileen by the Dixies Midnight Runners. Number 5, Living on a Prayer, Bon Jovi. Number 4, Dancing Queen. Number 3, Staying Alive. Number 2, Don't Stop Me Now, Queen. And the number 1, happiest song in the world, Mr. Blue Sky by ELO. So there you go. There's your happiest song. So, I saw that I wanted to read that because I just saw a story that said that Americans are the most depressed they've been in like the last 20 years. So, put those songs on and, you know, turn that frown upside down because it does burn more calories that way, you know, when you smile than when you frown. And so, you know, during this, quarantine and you're putting on the quarantine 15, do a little quarantine-tainment there with the happiest songs. So Tanner, let's do this, before we go to break. We've decided how we're going to give away the lit tickets. Now tell people when the show is going to be and what we're going to do for that.
So the show is August 29th at Tags on the Tags Summer Stage in Big Flats. Now, the way we're going to give away the tickets is, you know, we were looking through Lit's discography, trying, you know, looking through songs, trying to find something that would work. And they have a song called Fast. And you know what else is fast? Well, me. So what we're going to do is we're going to have me run the 40-yard dash. And whichever listener sends in the time closest to my 40-yard dash time without going over will win the tickets. Now, let me just give you guys a little bit of a window here to know what to expect. So I have the top five fastest and slowest 40-yard dashes from the NFL Combine since 2008. So up towards the top, you got 4.28 by Jacoby Ford, J.J. Nelson, Jalen Myrick, 4.27 by Marquise Goodwin, 4.26 Dre Archer, 4.24 Chris Johnson, and then the record 4.22 by John Ross. Now, a couple years ago, I ran like a 4.240. I just didn't have the cameras on at the time, media, wasn't as big back then.
Sure.
So, that was back when I was in my prime, but taking a look of more my range, now that I'm old and decrepit, I'm going to turn 20 here in 5 days. So top five slowest 40 times of all time. You've got 5.75 by Ricky Henry, an offensive lineman, 5.79 by Dace Richardson, another offensive lineman. These are all offensive linemen. 5.8 flat by Josh Oglesby, 5.84 by Damian Mama, and 6.06 by Isaiah Thompson. So that might be a little more realistic. My goal that I set for myself was Tom Brady. Tom Brady ran a 5.28, and he is, notorious for being slow. So if I finish with a slower time than Tom Brady, I'm going to be highly disappointed, but that's the goal. So 5.28 is the goal.
All righty. So you can get your entries in to 921theteam@gmail.com, 921theteam@gmail.com, or you can text us 607-363-TEAM, 363-TEAM. Give us your name, your number if you're emailing us, and your time. Okay? Now, if there's a tie, we will draw between the tied contestants. Okay? Now, we will we'll do this in about a month or so, okay? So it'll happen maybe the last weekend in July. And that gives you about a month if you win the tickets to make a plan to see Fuel and Lit on the summer stage at Tags. All right, Tanner, before we go to break, why don't you go ahead and throw that trivia question out?
All right. Who was the first baseball player to appear on a box of Wheaties? Choices being Lou Gehrig, Mel Ott, Babe Ruth, or Joe DiMaggio.
All righty. Let's take a break. Coming up, we've got Greg Kite, 12-year NBA vet on the other side, 2-time NBA champion with the Boston Celtics. We'll be right back after this.
Hot dogs, they're ice cold. Hamburgers, that pure gold. This one's for them hungry girls, them hungry boys with masterpiece. Styling, smiling, flipping it up in the city. I got Dockers on, who's Saint Laurent? I gotta kiss my wife, so pretty. Too hot,
hot dance.
Call the police and the fireman. I'm too hot,
hot dance.
Make a dragon wanna retire, man. I'm too hot,
hot dance.
What's my name? I'm your old man. I'm too hot,
hot dance.
Let's talk about that money, break it down. Wives hit you, hallelujah.
Ooh.
Girls hit you, hallelujah.
Ooh.
Boys hit you, hallelujah.
Ooh.
But this broke dad can't give it to you. No, this broke dad can't give it to you. Cause this broke dad can't give it to you. Cause it's Friday night, no need to fight. Don't believe it, just watch, go!
Father's Day is coming up. Do you have plans? Hello, this is Carl von Wehrmann. Everybody wants to do something nice for dad on Father's Day. But maybe your father isn't available. Maybe he lives in another state. Or maybe he's just a bitter old bastard who disowned his family. Anyway, that's where I come in. You can temporarily fill the void and alleviate the empty heartache by renting me for Father's Day. That's right. Pick me up at my modest apartment. Take me for a car ride. I'll sit in the back and I won't complain. Not even once about the cold air blowing on me. We can all go to a nice park where I can comment on how much the grandkids have grown. I do get around pretty good, if there aren't too many stairs. And afterwards, I'll tell you how proud I am of whatever you do for a living over a nice dinner out. I like pot roast and baked whitefish, nothing fried. Yes, relieve the guilt and relive the joy of Father's Day by renting me. Call 1-888-RENT-A-POP now and reserve your time. Half hour minimum required. Good spaces are still available, so call now, and I'll see you on Sunday, Sonny Boy.
Lewis Garage Doors of Hornell is now open for all your garage door needs. They've been serving the area for over 30 years. Lewis Garage Doors provides the best in sales, installation, service, and repair of your garage, overhead, and storage doors. Lewis Garage Doors is open Monday through Friday, 8 a.m. till 4 p.m. Phone 607-324-0271. 324-0271 for Lewis Garage Doors of Hornell.
Shopping Club. And we're back on the Radio Shopping Club. I'm your host, David. Now, as you know, Father's Day is right around the corner. And, hey, don't know what to get the old guy? Well, why actually ask Dad what he wants when you can be oh so traditional with the RSC Father's Day cliche package? Here they are, the best, most outdated gifts a dad could ever want. Now, here, take a look at this. Here you go. Set of cufflinks and a tie clasp. Huh? No man has worn this stuff since 1952, and your dad won't either. Now, here you go. The RSC Father's Day cliche package has golf balls, belts, here's a pair of socks. How about this gem? A kiss the cook apron, huh? That never gets old. Finally, if your dad likes the latest gadgets, forget the iPod and give him this electric shoe buffer. Hey, he doesn't even have to bend over. Perfect for sitting in the back of a closet unopened. Am I right? Of course I am. The RSC Father's Day cliche package, order now, and we'll throw in this free sample of High Karate Cologne. Yes, Dad will be fighting Mom off with limes. Call now. RSC, the radio
shopping club. Welcome back to the Joel Oriend Show.
I have to warn you, some of this is clearly inappropriate, and I'm serious, and it's not going to be fun for you, but we have to be aware of what's floating around out there. Okay, here is
Joel Oriend.
I don't want to talk to you. That's despicable. You can go. Absolutely despicable, and I refuse to publicize that. I think it's deplorable, and I think it is an insult to my intelligence.
On 92.1 The Team.
Thank you so much, Dr. Phil. I appreciate that. Our next guest, Greg Kite, was a standout high school basketball player, went to BYU, had a good career there, was picked 21st overall in the 1983 NBA draft, played 12 years in the league for the Boston Celtics, Orlando Magic, LA Clippers, Sacramento Kings, Charlotte Hornets, Indiana Pacers, and the New York Knicks. 680 games in total, over 1,700 points, 2,600 rebounds, 400 blocks, and over 10,000 minutes logged in the league. Two NBA championships in 1984 and 1986. Let's bring them on. It's Greg Kite. Greg, thanks so much for joining us.
Great to be on with you, Joel. Can't say that I've run into Dr. Phil, but did run into Dr. J a few times.
Well, you and the Celtics certainly had some great battles with Dr. J and the 76ers through the 80s. That's for sure. And we'll get to some of those great battles you had with Dr. J and other All-Star and Hall of Fame players throughout your NBA career. But let's start with this. Your bio says you are 6'11". So I guess my question for you is, because right now my 17-year-old son, his biggest goal in life, it's not to buy a house. It's not to have $1 million. It's not to get married. It's not to have a great job. It's not to graduate high school or go to college. It's to be able to dunk a basketball. So when were you able to throw down a basketball for the first time, Greg?
I think, number one, I think dunking is a worthy goal. That's a good thing to have. It was the seventh or eighth grade. I'm getting old, but I believe towards the end of my seventh grade year, I was able to dunk, yes.
Yep, so I read you were 6'10 by age 15, hence you gave up all other sports to pursue basketball. First part of this question is, what other sports did you play growing up through high school, and did you always want to play basketball professionally, or was it that growth spurt that pretty much made it all but certain that you were going to play basketball moving forward?
Well, Joel, I mean, Tanner, I loved all sports, still do. Looking back, I kind of wish I'd played a little bit longer in high school. I played baseball and football and was involved in some of the track events too. But, I loved them all, but 19th grade, I really kind of wanted to focus and specialize. And our seasons there, especially in high school, they would overlap. It wasn't like some states where basically you're through, you know, before you start the next season. They would overlap. Some of the regular season would overlap. So I didn't want to miss any. But when it comes to football, just here's a little aside. In high school, my high school basketball coach was the offensive line football coach. He would have been glad to have me come out. And in college every year at BYU, Lavelle Edwards, or one of the assistant coaches, would always ask me if I was going to come out for spring practice. And who knows, I might have been a little bit better than that. But as far as the growth spurt and winning, I wanted to play pro basketball ever since I was 10 years old, when I kind of first started playing my first organized team at a YMCA there in Houston, Texas, where I grew up. I wanted to be a high school basketball player like my brother was then, but I also, you know, got to see college games with like Elvin Hayes at University of Houston. I wanted to be a college player and wanted to be a pro basketball player. That kind of sealed the deal when I was 10 or 11. I got to go to a couple of clinics around town, with one where Elvin Hayes was at, another one where Rudy Tomjanovich was at. And so ever since then, I knew I wanted to. And then playing baseball as like a 15-year-old with a 6'10 strike zone, when the kid in the All-Star game struck me out 3 times, I knew it was time to switch to switch sports. I'll take a little bit of pass. At least that kid was a really good pitcher. He went on to pitch at Texas A&M. So, but I couldn't handle those curveballs of this.
Greg, let me ask you. So my son, again, he's fixated on height. You know, he wants to be 7'5", 7'6", at least 7'1". He's not going to hit that. He didn't get the height gene from me. That's for sure. I'm 5'11 and 3/4", but I'm 5'11 and a quarter, probably. But back when I was a young buck and a wild and free, young man on the dating websites, I used to put 6 foot because I just feel like 6 foot sounds so much better than 5'11". Now on paper, you are 6'11". When you're 6'11", do you want to be 7 foot as bad as when you're 5'11" and want to be 6 foot?
Well, you said on paper. So, you know, now as you get older, you shrink a little bit. So if I stand on a phone book, if those still exist, I'm over 7 feet. Yeah, no, I don't know. In my shoes, I was probably like 6'11 and a half or something like that. So, but you know, it's interesting about that, you know. Everybody thinks about athletes, especially basketball players, in terms of height. You know, we don't play the game with the top of our head, but height is what we relate to. So really, in basketball and a lot of sports, it's more about reach. Now, how far can you reach? I mean, just an example, Kevin McHale, we were about the same height. He might have been a half an inch shorter or something, but he could reach 5 or 6 inches higher than I could. So that's where you get shots off. That's where you grab rebounds. That's where you block shots. So the long arms are where it's at, no matter what your size are. And when you get tired, you might not jump as high or as quick, but your arms don't get any shorter. Yeah, Kevin, Cedric Maxwell, Dennis Johnson, Robert Parrish, all, you know, long arm guys. And, you know, so you'll see it across the board with, you know, elite basketball players. A lot of them are extra long arm, big hands, two great big assets.
So you were a great player at every level, high school, college, and the NBA, doing exactly what you needed to do and really excelling at your role at each level. In high school, you were a dominant player, 18 points, 15 rebounds per game. In college, 6 points, 7 rebounds per game at BYU. And then in the NBA, you were a great role player, a banger down low on the block with some of the greatest centers in NBA history. So they say that sometimes the toughest losses hang with you longer than the greatest wins. The bitter losses are more bitter than the sweetest wins are sweet. So in high school, your team is undefeated. You make it to the state semis. You're ranked number one in Texas. You take on Lifkin in the state semis and you lose. In college in 81 at BYU, you guys are having a great year. You make it to the Eastern Regionals. You lose to Ralph Sampson and Virginia. And then in 85, you guys with the Celtics are trying to repeat against the Lakers. You lose game 6 and losing the NBA Finals 4-2. Which one of those 3 losses do you remember or hurts the most for you?
And you bring up some bad memories. I think I had a nightmare last night about all 3 of them. You do. Sometimes you remember the losses more than the wins, but all of them were rough. I got to say, in some ways, that one in high school was as bad as any. I mean, we were 39-0, we ranked like 5th in the nation. I was a McDonald's All-American, and we were loaded. We had other D1 athletes on our team, and not that Lufkin didn't. They had a couple of D1 kids, but we just came out flat. We're in the state semifinals at University of Texas with a big crowd, and it was a terribly disappointing loss. You know, the NCAA won. We had the chance to go to the final eight. I mean, the final four. We beat Ralph Sampson of Virginia, and we gave him a game for about 2/3 of the games, and they got a run on us. But Ralph was. We had Danny Ainge, who was Player of the Year through that year. But Ralph was incredible back then in college before he got into some injuries in the pros. So I don't know. It would have been a tough stretch to beat them. And of course the Lakers we did beat them, you know, one of those years in the finals, but that series in 85 was definitely a tough one.
So in high school you were recruited by some of the top level D1 schools, you know, Duke, Kentucky, UCLA. Ultimately you chose BYU, who at the time was a program on the rise. You mentioned Danny Ainge, it would be your first time joining up with him as a teammate. What made you end up choosing BYU in the end?
Well, I had a lot of great choices. Like you said, some of those schools you mentioned were some of the ones that I visited on my official visits, and would have had a great choice anywhere. And I grew up there in Houston, was played a lot with the University of Houston players. University of Texas had a good team. But BYU overall, one, I just thought about it, prayed about it, talked to my coach, my parents, and I just kind of felt it was the best place for me, not only basketball-wise, but academically, socially, spiritually. And if nothing else, number one, I met my wife there. We played on the women's team. She's from Orlando, Florida, where we live and lived during my pro career, where we live now. So that was the best choice there of all. Once I met her, it can't beat that. We did have a good career. And they, you know, a lot of maybe not as well known nationally currently as some of those teams, but they've had a long history of very good basketball programs. Even back in the 50s and 60s, they won some of the national championships then, and what was a premier championship, the NIT. And so, yeah, they definitely had a resurgence then. Danny was 2 years ahead of me the year before. Three high school All-Americans who had long pro careers, Fred Roberts, Stephen Durant, a guy named Steve Trumbo, played him in Europe. So us combined, our coach, Frank Arnold, back then had just left UCLA, where he was assistant with John Wooden for a number of years, including their 88-game winning streak. So we had a great program. You know, and they're back right now. They've got a good resurgence right now with the new coach there that they had, Mark Pope, and had an exciting team to watch last year. So BYU's got great athletics. It was also, I had some family roots in the area. My mom was part of her childhood years in Salt Lake, and graduated from high school there, and actually had attended BYU as well as a couple of my siblings. So there was a family connection, but overall, it was a great choice for me.
Well, like you said, I did bring up some painful losses for you, but you dealt one of our former guests one of their most painful losses. So on that BYU team of yours in 81, where you make the run to the East Regionals, you beat UCLA, Princeton, and Notre Dame. And one of the guys on that Notre Dame team is Slater Mo Joe Klein. We had Joe on, and he talked about that 51-50 loss to your Cougs in that 81 tournament. He said that was one of his most painful losses.
Yeah, we did. Notre Dame had a great team. Joe was someone on our roster, and they had Kelly Chaprica and John Paxson and Orlando Woolridge, Tracy Jackson, a guy who played in the league for a while, another good center, Tim Andre. So they were loaded, and we had a great comeback and a miracle drive by full court with 7 seconds left for Danny Ainge to hit the game-winning floater over the outstretched arm to Orlando Woolridge. I was, by the way, myself and our big forward were wide open under the basket, but Danny never passed the ball anyway. So he knew what he was doing. Our coach knew what he was doing, too. We were there to clean up the garbage in case something happened.
So your college career ends. You get drafted 21st overall by one of the most famous and legendary and successful sports franchises, the Boston Celtics, as they're putting together that dynasty of the 80s, where you guys make multiple finals trips and win in 84 and 86. That must have been extremely exciting to get drafted in the first round by the Celtics.
Yeah, it was. It was awesome. And, you know, in those days, the draft wasn't quite the spectacle it was here. And I think they had a few people up in New York, and it was like on TNT. Boston had seen me, scouted me, but I didn't even have back then any sort of in-person workout for them or interviews. We'd played my senior year in the Holiday Classic in Madison Square Garden, and Red was there. And then I did well in some postseason NBA pre-draft camp and another All-Star game, the Aloha Classic. So those things helped. But I was sitting in my in-laws' family room watching the draft on Turner back then, or TNT, and that's when I first learned I was being drafted by the Celtics, and of course quickly after that I got a call, and then a few weeks later, after he signed, they had rookie free agent camp. The Celtics had it for many years in Marshfield, Massachusetts, then going down towards the Cape at a summer camp that one some family that connected to the Celtics owned. And Red was there on his golf cart, and we practiced during the day on outside courts, and we went to the high school gym at night to scrimmage. So it was great being part of that with Red. I know, they actually, with that pick, they were hoping to pick up Roy Hinton, who was very talented, and he got picked by the Cavs before me. But the Celtics had picked up that pick. They had traded Rick Roby, a backup center, to the Phoenix Suns for Dennis Johnson, and for the rights to the draft pick, where they were able to pick me. So, in essence, they needed to fill in somebody for Roby's spot. So that's what I was able to provide for him.
I know it's extremely hard to compare different generations, but does the 1984 or 86 Celtics beat any of those 90 Jordan Bulls championship teams?
I think they would. Yeah, that 86 team, all those 86 teams. Not that it wouldn't be a battle, and not that it would, wouldn't be a close series, but, and really when you get down to the playoffs, too, it goes into matchups and it goes into health. That's a big factor, is how healthy is your team. And, like in 87, we were beat up, and you see that. I mean, going 4 years a row in the NBA finals, or five, like a little bit younger group, the Warriors just did, you start to get some wear and tear on those wheels. I think of Dwayne Wade and Chris Bosh and what happened with the Heat. And then you get some of these injuries with the guys with the Warriors. But the guys in the Celtics at the end of that era were the key guys were in their mid-30s or early 30s, and Bird's injuries, McHale's, things like that. So, but that was a pretty incredible team. We were very good before, but bring on Bill Walton, who was healthy that year, and then we had picked up Jerry Seasting. Plus me, they let me buy a ticket to go tour the Hall of Fame. So, Walton, even though, saddled by injury his whole career and multiple surgeries, he was still an incredible pickup, and what a great combo to, go with that front line of Parrish, Bird, McHale. I mean, Jordan's phenomenal, Pippen's phenomenal, other great role players, but there's nobody going to match up with that front line, and our backcourt wasn't too bad either. Danny might not have been able to hold Jordan one-on-one, and it's tough for DJ too, but at least Danny could go take his money on the golf course.
Now, some would say you were a member of the greatest NBA basketball team, if not one of the greatest basketball teams ever assembled, in that 1986 NBA championship team for the Boston Celtics. You guys beat the Rockets in the finals. You averaged 114 points per game. That was eighth highest in the league that year. You had the third fewest points per game, so you guys played defense as well. And it was a deep team. I think there was like four or five Hall of Famers on that team, one of them coming off of the bench in Bill Walton. It was such a deep team. Who would you say is a unsung hero or underrated on that team? We hear about the Hall of Famers a ton, but who would you say, because it was great role players, you and Jerry Seastings and Scott Webman. The team was just so deep. You guys would come off the bench and play some crucial and important minutes in the playoffs. But who would you say was an unsung hero or underrated on that 86 Celtics team?
Well, the five Hall of Famers were Dennis Johnson, Bird, Parrish, McHale, and Walton. So, the guy who played the most and was very effective with an All-Star year, too, was Danny Ainge. You can look at that, but other guys who were, and he started, much of that time, but part of that trade for the 84-85 teams before Walton was there was Cedric Maxwell, and Cedric was certainly, key. I mean, he's the MVP of the playoff series in 84, maybe even in 81. And then other guys like, ML Carr, and the leadership and the energy that he brought, Quinn Buckner, Scott Webman, who you mentioned, talk about great shooter and just a great stroke and a pro. Scott was an awesome weapon to have. And then, what good teams that contend do is obviously they keep that core together, but then they they tweak some of the parts, you know. And so, the you know, as you age or contracts get up or whatever, injuries, then they tweak those parts. So you got a Bill Walton filling in for taking a Maxwell's place, and you got a Jerry Seastein coming along when a Quinn Buckner or somebody else isn't there anymore. And so all those guys filled a great role. And, you know, that's what's really important, you know, about a championship team is that, you know, in general, you got experienced older guys. So young guys like me coming in often don't play a lot besides playing all the talent you have. But every game on a championship contender through the regular season, no matter what the guys these days say about it, is so important because you're playing for home court advantage. Right. So having a guy who's got some experience, who's a 10th, 11th, 12th, 9th man, whatever, and can help you one night or for a game or two here and there and help you win a ball game is huge. Same thing as going to the playoffs, you know. You can swing a series on a role guy. So we had a lot of those guys. Sam Vincent, a lot of all those guys on the team all played great roles and helped us with what we did there.
Greg, let's take a break. We got to take a timeout here and pay the bills, play a couple commercials, and we'll come back. I want to ask Greg his thoughts on the NBA coming back and how they all have to play in the same arena, so there's no home court advantage for the higher seeds. Want to get his thoughts on if that's important or not in his mind. Want to talk to him about some of the legendary players he played with, like Larry Bird, and some of the great centers he had to go up against. Also, he helped tutor and bring along one of the greatest centers in NBA history when he was with the Orlando Magic. Want to ask him about that as well. Let's take a break. Greg Kite hanging out with us, the two-time NBA champ with the Boston Celtics in 1984 and 86. We'll be right back at this.
And now, a gentle reminder that Father's Day is
Sunday, Sunday, Sunday! Sunday is Father's Day!
Your dad!
Your pop!
The man asleep on the couch!
The man with the supercharged 24-cylinder nitro-fuel temper!
So don't you dare miss his day!
On Sunday!
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 The man who told you to walk it off, big sissy!
When you broke your arm outside the Civic Arena!
The man who taught you to drive the family minivan!
Like a super colossal 4x4 car-crushing monster truck!
So buy him another crappy tie!
On Sunday!
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 He's the guy who talked to the birds and bees
over a plate of wings and Hooters.
Don't get the man a beer.
Let him have the remote control.
And leave the guy alone.
Because that's what he really wants for Father's Day.
On Sunday.
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 Because he's your dad, that's why.
At UR Medicine, we're taking urgent care in a whole new direction by offering telemedicine so you can get help anywhere and adding things on site for increased safety, like symptom screenings, reconfigured waiting areas, rigorous disinfection, and masks for everyone. We know illness and injuries won't stop. Neither will we. Urgent Care Redesigned. Go to urgentcare.urmc.edu.
Welcome back to the Joel Oriend Show.
Winner, winner, chicken dinner.
On 92.1 The Team.
We got a winner on our phone line. Greg Kite went to four NBA finals in a row, 84, 85, 86, 87, winning 84 and 86. Played 12 years in the league with the Celtics, the Magic, the Clippers, the Hornets, the Knicks, and the Pacers. I want to ask you about the situation with this year's NBA. So they've decided they're going to get together down in Disneyland, down in your neck of the woods, and they're going to play the NBA playoffs in one location. So there's no home court advantage. So the top seeds aren't going to get that home court advantage. And home court advantage in the NBA might be the most important out of any sport. The numbers just bear it out more times than not, even if it goes to a game seven. The home team wins. Back when you were playing, it was tough to go on the road and get a win in the Boston Garden, the Forum, the Spectrum in Philadelphia, the United Center in Chicago, Madison Square Garden in New York City. Those were tough places to go, real hostile environments. So I guess I have a twofold question for you. A, do you believe that home court advantage is extremely important when it comes to the NBA playoffs? And B, they've talked about trying to do things to give an advantage to the higher seed. More timeouts, extra possession, more fouls. You're allowed to bring your own baskets in court from your home arena. You get to stay closer to the arena than the other team. They have to stay farther away in a hotel further away or not as nice of a hotel. Do you think that they should do any gimmicky things to try to give an advantage to the top seed?
Hey, I think it is very important. I mean, statistically, this bears it out that it is not that the team with the home court advantage always wins, but typically it's a big role. And then you get to those pivotal games when you have the traditional 2-2, 1-1, 1 series that you're paying at those key swing games like game five on your home court when you got the home court advantage or not in game seven. So it'd be really interesting here down in Orlando, you know, to kind of negate the home court advantage. Probably going to send the bookies who make lines on things to drive them crazy a little bit, because obviously they factor in all those different things. Not that I know a lot about that stuff, but I think what they decided on, I heard about some of those things you mentioned about extra timeouts, but I think they decided on, you know, most or all that stuff was too gimmicky. They didn't want to, you know, tweak the rules or anything like that. So it's really going to kind of be a level playing ground as you're playing a best of seven series, and really nobody has a leg up. I guess it may be more of who's gone crazy staying in the bubble for so many weeks and who's a little more sane.
Well, that's certainly true. That's going to be part of it. It's going to be a mental test. Who can stay in the moment? Who can stay focused and not go stir crazy and climb the walls and lose concentration because you're stuck in one place for so long? I want to jump to game three of the 87 finals. This is an important game. You guys are down 0-2, okay? And now, you've probably heard this a million times, but if I was you, I wouldn't get sick of hearing about it. And just for those listeners that maybe aren't aware or haven't heard this, I want to go ahead and read this. On June 7th, 1987, in Game 3 of the NBA Finals, with Robert Parrish in foul trouble and Bill Walton ailing, Kite was called upon by coach Casey Jones to match up against Kareem Abdul-Jabbar for 22 minutes. He responded with defense that tired Jabbar and blocked a shot by Magic Johnson. Kite had 0 points, 9 rebounds, 2 assists, 1 block, and 5 fouls in his 22 minutes, and his play helped propel the Celtics to a 109-103 victory. After the game, Lakers coach Pat Riley said, quote, "Kite didn't score a point. It looked like he had 100. Also, Larry Bird said, quote, "I've seen Greg play real well at times. He's got limited offensive ability, but he's a banger, and he is probably our hardest worker. He kept Kareem off balance and got a lot of rebounds. His work ethic finally paid off. He stayed with his game and did a real good job." It's really got to feel awesome to hear two Hall of Famers like that, Pat Riley and Larry Bird, give you praise like that.
Oh yeah, that was great. It was a great moment. It's a great memory. It was exciting to get to play. It was always exciting any minutes to get to play, but to play extended minutes like it did, and the circumstances did it. And, you know, one of the things that I did well in the NBA was I did a pretty good job of defending. And when I would, and in the post, they usually didn't double team, you know, which can really cause havoc, especially with a guy like Kareem, who's such a great scorer and passer. So, I'd had stretches in other series and other regular season games against Kareem and other good centers where I'd play a few minutes, but it, you know, worked out there. And most any NBA player, I mean, people don't always get it, but you're talking, you know, even now 450, back then 350 players, you know, so it's not like anybody in the league's a dog. You know, you get the chance to play and you do things. Now there's only one ball out there, so not everybody's going to score. And if Larry had passed it to me a little bit more, maybe I could have scored a little bit more. But he knew what he was doing, too, just like Ainge did in that Notre Dame game. But, you know, that again, you know, half the game is not even with the ball. Your team doesn't even have the ball. So being a good defender, a good rebounder, being able to do things on offense that – don't necessarily always involve the ball, and being competent when you have the ball is good. But it was huge. I mean, I loved anybody appreciates getting recognized, but certainly, you know, with, from Larry and Pat Riley, I couldn't, those are great compliments.
You played with some guys who are known for their trash talk, guys like Larry Bird and Reggie Miller, and I was going to ask if you had any specific stories, including those two, whether it was something you saw in practice or during a game, and do you have any other memorable trash talk stories from your career?
You know, Larry loved to win. I mean, he was a great, and he appreciated guys who worked hard and were team players, and he was certainly a team player. But, you know, the one thing, Larry was as mentally tough as anybody. You know, he wasn't afraid to fail. And one of the things that he used was, Kevin McHale used to call it stealing other guys' brainwaves, you know. It's what they do. The art of trash talking, like Kevin and Larry, and you see this with some other good players, it's getting in somebody's head. And they did a great, he was awesome at that. You can go on YouTube and watch some of these videos of like, Xavier McDaniel saying, Larry said, I'm gonna catch the ball right here, shoot it in your face, before the timeout. I'm gonna catch it right here and shoot it in your face and hit the game winner, you know, stuff like that.
Right.
Larry was always talking to the other opponents and things like that. And that was great stuff. And that probably, probably a little bit of way that he got his mind into it, but it's fun stuff. And, people don't think about that. You hear some of these guys trash talking and getting mad at each other and things like that.
Right.
That happens in tempers flare. But you think about sports, part of the sports is a little bit of the mind game when it's team sports or you're going head to head with somebody. I mean, baseball, the pitcher does it with a close pitch to the chin or a glare out there on the mound, with a home run hitter or great story, Don Baylor, a friend of ours, Bruce Hurst, who pitched the Red Sox. Don Baylor got hit by a pitch and he said he just reached up and grabbed the ball and it hit his shoulder and tossed it back to him on the mound. So the pitcher, you're sitting there, my stuff isn't very hard. I'm not throwing this very hard. Larry, he was awesome at that. Yeah. Using the competitiveness, using the mind game, finding ways to win.
Yep.
If you got a minute, I'll tell you a great story about being a competitor.
Sure.
And having a class about him. So we're playing in New York. And Nick's longtime trainer, Mike Saunders, before the game, gets Larry was out shooting real early or something, or shooting the bowl and trading jabs. And Larry and Mike says, I'll bet you $5 if you don't bank in a 3-pointer during the game. And so Larry said, you're on. So we're playing this game, and it's like a close game, and it gets down to like the last 45 seconds, and the Knicks are up like 2 points, and there's a dead ball, and Saunders there by the coaches, the trainer stands up and catches Larry Eye and smiles and holds up 5 fingers, like, I gotcha. Very next trip down, we're down 2. Larry comes and shoots a 3-pointer and banks it in. Smiles back. And then maybe you've seen the one, the one where he, out in Portland, he played left-handed.
Yes,
he shot every shot left-handed during the game and scored like 32 points or something. Scott Skiles was a really good trash talker. He was the point guard here with us in, for some of the time in, almost all the time I was with Orlando, and, great competitor, great player. A good player, but maybe a little less smaller, so feisty, scrappy. One of the great stories about him he told was, Bob Knight, Scott used to go and do things, and Larry did a little bit of this too. Like he'd have a run, he'd make a couple good passes, hit a couple jumpers, he'd run by the other opposing coach and tell him he needed to call a timeout.
Right.
You might want to think about calling a timeout, coach, or you got anybody over there who can guard me? And so probably in college, Scott would say this, he didn't hold any punches about it, so he said those kind of things too, and one of them was Bobby Knight. So Bobby Knight had a tradition of shaking the hand of every senior in the Big Ten their last game that they played at IU, and apparently the only guy he wouldn't shake his hands with was Scott Skiles, and Scott loved it. Scott loved that kind of stuff.
That is a good story, getting under the general's skin. Let me ask you about this point in your career. You're with the Celtics, you go to 4 NBA finals in a row, 84, 85, 86, 87, you win in 84 and 86, you then go from maybe the greatest sports franchise, at least in the NBA, to the worst sports franchise, maybe in all of sports, the Donald Sterling ran LA Clippers.
It was kind of night and day organizationally and winning wise. It was sometimes like in the, and not to knock the organization down, but sometimes kind of like you didn't know what the right and left hand was doing. On the other hand, though, for me as a young player, it was a great opportunity to, I didn't want to leave the Celtics. You know, I loved the Celtics. It was obviously a wonderful situation there, even with those guys aging, to stick around. But it did give me an opportunity that I didn't have in Boston to play more. And usually, you know, players establish their worth in the league, whether they're a fringe player at the end of the bench or a guy in the rotation as a backup or a starter or whatever by playing minutes. So going there and with the Clippers and later the next few years with the brief stint with the Hornets, the Kings, and the Magic helped to establish myself. I did start a lot, but at least it created value for me as a good backup center, and it gave me more of a chance to become more consistent and do a little bit more things. So basketball-wise, it was great. Got to play for Gene Shue, who was a heck of a basketball coach. Played with some really good guys, and we had some talented guys, Mike Woodson, Norm Nixon, Michael Cage, others, Larry Drew, et cetera, and Quentin Daly. Some good guys, but the Clippers, you know, had a long history of kind of a lot of bad luck and being in disarray. And one thing that we knew a little bit about Sterling, and he was kind of a, you know, eccentric, you know, little ego-driven big guy. I didn't know any of the racial stuff, but we knew there was some penny pinching going on. And one of the things that we did, we practiced in about 7 different places. And I discovered later it was probably because they weren't paying the bills. Some of them, and they had to go to another gym, you know. And it was different in that. In that aspect. But like I said, it was a good opportunity, and it was nice weather in Southern California too, versus, you know, the winter in Boston. We lived not too far from the beach and go play beach volleyball. It was nice.
Yeah, I've heard Doc Rivers say in interviews, and that's kind of why I was surprised Doc went to the Clippers to work for Donald Sterling, but Doc said when he was a player and played for the Clippers that sometimes they didn't have hot water after practice in the shower. So certainly there was some penny pinching and a little bit of a stinginess, if you want to say, from Donald Sterling. So you then go from the Clippers to a young franchise, the Orlando Magic, and your first year, you start all 82 games, you're getting lots of minutes, you're playing well, the team is starting to build towards that NBA Finals appearance, and they decide they're going to draft this young whippersnapper by the name of Shaquille O'Neal, and you do a great job of helping to mentor and teach and work with him as he grew into a great player with the Magic.
Yeah, so this guy Shaq comes along, and they give him my starting job, and I've never gotten an explanation why since, but I'm slowly figuring it out. But anyway, Shaq was phenomenal. You know, our coach was Matt Gukas, and Matt had played with the Philadelphia Warriors, I think it was, when Wilt Chamberlain was with them. And Dukas was like a rookie, a young player, and Wilt was like late 20s and kind of physically mature. And he said, you know, even when they were thinking about drafting him, he said, Shaq is physically the closest thing to, only anybody ever close to him was Wilt. He just had so much size and strength and quickness, power, that he was incredible, could run, move quick, you know, and then he got better and better as his skills as he went along. So, yeah, instantly with Shaq, it made a big difference that my third year there with the Magic, and I became the backup center for him, and occasionally playing some spot minutes at a big forward. But that was kind of an ideal situation. I thought, here I am in my, whatever I was in, 33 or something, and we're going to be a really good team. And then the next year they pick up Penny Hardaway in the draft. Man, oh man, Penny's phenomenal. We're going to be even better. And here I'm the backup center for Shaq. Maybe I can ride this thing till I'm 43 or something, or at least a few more years, even a few more years of my contract, and fill that role as the backup for him. And then, boom, in January of my fourth year there, Penny's first year, Shaq's second year, we're playing in Madison Square Garden, and I go up for a rebound, and I thought I got stung by an electric cable. Something popped in my left Achilles, and I partially tore my Achilles tendon. And so I was in a boot now for the rest of the season, recovered during the summer, but under contract by the time training camp rolled around. They had other people in. They picked up Horace Grant at free agency, and they decided to move on from me. So I didn't get to, you know, go with them during that championship run, but that was a very, with Penny and Shaq, you know, and the other guys they had around them, what an incredibly talented team. It's too bad for the Magic. They couldn't have held that together for a few more years because they could have had a great long run with those guys.
On the phone with us, former NBA center Greg Kite played in the league from 1983 to 1994 with the Celtics, Magic, Hornets, Clippers, Knicks, and Pacers. Okay, Greg, you're back on defense, and there's a breakaway. Would you rather have to be back and try to stop Dr. J, Dominique Wilkins, or Michael Jordan?
Oh boy, it wouldn't matter because I would just foul one of them and they wouldn't dunk on me. You know, all three of those guys, could you know, take off from wherever and dunk on anybody. So there's really not a pick in your poison.
Yeah, but, that's right.
You know, Dominique Wilkins for in-game dunks. Mm-hmm. He had probably some of the most ferocious in-game dunks of anybody. I mean, some of Jordan's dunks and certainly Dr. J's just beauty and grace. And not that Dominique's weren't beautiful, but they were also
powerful.
Nasty. You know, he'd go up and just throw it down hard.
Yep. Well, I know what I would do. I would make sure that my hair was neatly combed and turn and try to find the camera and smile because I know I'm about ready to get posterized and be on a kid's wall for a long time to come. As I mentioned, in the league for 12 years, you played against some incredible centers, some Hall of Fame centers. Some guys that are 6'11", 7 foot, 7'1", like you, that are big, physical, muscular, boxy bangers. Then you played against guys like Bradley and Manute Bol and Mark Eaton, who are 7'4", 7'5", 7'6", 7'7". So would you rather play someone like a Hakeem and Patrick Ewing and bigger centers who are not that tall, or the telephone pole type centers who are really tall but very skinny and not very strong on the box?
I really liked, because it was one of my stronger suits too, I really liked the opportunities when I got to play against those guys who were the 6'11", 7 foot, 7'1" guys, and they were solid and were also focal points of their offense, because that was really a challenge. You know, if you got one of those other post players, an O'Neal, Malone, Olajuwon, you know, they're throwing the ball to that guy 30, 35 times a game, and it's tough. It's challenging. Or guarding a big forward like Karl Malone, they're setting screens for him, and it was tough. It's a different story. Not that you're not active and helping when you're guarding Manute or Mark Eaton or Mark West or some other center who's good player, but they're just not the focal point of the offense. And I tell you, though, Sean Bradley or Manute or Mark Eaton, it certainly, you know, you certainly thought about it when you're trying to shoot the ball or change the way you had to try to get a shot off. So those type of guys were game changers. But I love the center or post guy where the offense flows through. It's a tough thing to learn. It's sad that there's not more players now who do it, because it's a great, beautiful part of the game, and the analytics are there that if you can get the ball to a guy in the low post and get scored and fouled and pass the ball, it's just as effective at shooting threes. But that's what I enjoyed.
For you, who was the toughest defender on you when you got the ball in the low post and on the block? Who really gave you fits down low?
For them to guard me, well, God, they didn't have much of a problem with me. I tell you, the one that was scariest, and it was me guarding him, was Bill Cartwright. Bill had was a good player and had a good, really good reverse pivot. And when he did that, his elbows were up high and they cleared out space. And one time in Chicago, I got the hat trick from Bill Cartwright. He reverse pivot, his elbow hit me in the cheekbone. I got hurt, he scored the basket, and they called a foul on me. So that was the hat trick. all of those guys he named could make you look silly defensively by, you know, blocking your shot and just where they could go get a rebound or get the ball. So they're all a challenge. But Akeem was phenomenal. Yeah.
On the phone with us, Greg Kite. Now, Greg, you have an affiliation with the Florida Basketball Association, correct?
I do. I'm the commissioner of the Florida Basketball Association. They've been going for about 9 years now, and it's one of the longest running kind of minor league basketball programs in the country. It doesn't take a whole lot of my time. There's a guy named Mark King down here who founded it, runs one of the teams in it, but it's kind of a niche season in the spring or summer. Some guys who end up playing low levels overseas. A couple of guys who've had a cup of coffee in the G League, and they play about 15 to 18 games, and just here in Florida normally. That's what we do. So it works kind of on a minor league basis, and I've always stayed involved in basketball. Some of the ways I actually been involved with private school, with high school, and helping start high school basketball program there, and still will be involved in that. So those are kind of my two things basketball wise right now.
All right, Greg, let me ask you. I want to talk about this seminal moment in your career. You hit one 3-pointer. Do you know what year and against who?
Man, I'm not sure if I remember the opponent, but I was with the Sacramento Kings.
Yep.
So it's a good chance it was a Western Conference opponent,
yep.
But you know what? I led the league in field goal percentage, 3-point field goal percentage that year.
That's right, you did.
I was one for one.
You were.
I stopped when I was ahead, kind of like Gale Sayers. And,
that's right.
And so shot clock was going down, and I was in the right place at the right time and shot it. But you know. You know what, I kind of love what they're doing. I'd love to be playing now.
Right.
Because everybody's got the green light, and really, back then, it really wasn't, you know, looked upon.
Right.
Like you're going to, you know, for the most part, you know, your team shot 10 3-pointers in the game.
Right.
And that was a lot in the 80s and even starting into the early 90s.
Right.
But, you know, it makes a lot of sense. You know, the guys like Joe Klein, me, some of these guys who are, it's tough to get a shot off and against those long arm guys. So shooting an open jump shot was a lot easier thing to do, and it's, you know, who was the opponent? I don't remember. Who were we playing then?
Yeah, but you're right. So you were with the Kings. It was January 6th, 1990, at home in Sacramento against the Portland Trailblazers. You guys came up short 124 to 121.
The Kings lost by 3.
Yep.
So there you go. Vince Mata was the coach. I was Danny Ainge again was one of the guards. Vinny Del Negro, Kenny Smith. I was hot. You know, you just had to give me the ball one or two more times.
Had to feed you more.
Trailblazers. Yeah, feed the beast.
Feed the beast. Speaking of eating, any plans? I know you and your wife, you have the 10 adopted children. So any big plans tomorrow for Father's Day for you?
Nothing that they've informed me of. We're pretty low key. Probably just dinner at home and my father-in-law. My wife's family, they're in town, so we'll probably go see them. But, I mean, they live here. No big plans. We've got three of our youngest kids our three youngest kids are home with the school being out and layoffs with the COVID-19 stuff. So we're just probably a little get together at home with them is all. But happy Father's Day to you and all the other fathers out there as well.
Thanks, Greg. I appreciate it. Enjoy that lovely family tomorrow on Father's Day. Continued success with your wealth management company and the Florida Pro Basketball Association, and continued health for you and your family. Thanks so much for coming on, Greg.
Thank you very much, Joel. Thank you, Tanner. Great to talk to you guys. Take care.
All right. There you go. Greg Kite, 12-year vet of the NBA from 83 to 94, played for the Celtics, the Clippers, Magic, Hornets, Pacers, and the Knicks. Scored over 1,700 points, over 2,600 rebounds, over 400 blocks, and logged over 10,000 minutes in his 680 games in the NBA. Let's take a break. We'll be right back after this.
I might seem crazy, but I'm kind of cool. Yeah, I'ma throw you super high in the pool. Yeah, I should probably warn you, I just went in there. But I also let my daughter braid my hair. Don't care, 'cause I'm your daddy. Clap along if you let them jump around. Clap along if you buy them cones that are big.
with your silly spray. Let's dance together because I'm your
daddy.
Clap along if you clean his hair by car wash vacuuming.
Because I'm your daddy.
Clap along if you let him hang on while you are biking.
Because I'm your daddy.
Clap along if you are the sponsor and they are cheerleading.
Because I'm your daddy.
Clap along if you're a fire truck and he's the one riding. One more verse, here we go.
Daddy.
Clap along if you fill the mouth with a whole bunch of whipped cream.
Because I'm your daddy.
Clap along if there is no limit for kids on the trampoline.
Because I'm your daddy.
The one that does Library of Canisteo will reopen on Monday, June 29th at 10 a.m. for curbside service. This means the staff will begin taking calls for book and movie checkouts at 10 a.m., phone 607-698-4445. The library will be open Monday through Saturday with the hours of 10 a.m. till noon reserved for pickup for those who consider themselves to be at high risk. Then from noon till 4 p.m., library pickups will be available to all others, but for curbside service only at this time. Checkouts will be limited to two items. Again, that number is 698-4445. Now, conditions are expected to change rapidly, so please stay tuned for actual in-house service.
Welcome back to the Joel Oriend Show.
Hi, honey. How was your day?
Hey, I came home. How good could it have been?
On 92.1 The Team.
Saw this article. It's more of a list, I suppose, on The Athletic. They really dove into some numbers and came up with the most dominant teams of the last 50 years from 1970 through 2019. And so there's the top 25. And then they break it down by each organization and franchise. So the most dominant team in each franchise history. So I thought it'd be interesting. You know, I've not been alive for the whole thing, but being born in 1976, I've seen most of the teams either live or, you know, in replays or whatnot. So I thought maybe it'd be interesting to see if I could guess what teams were the most dominant for a few of the franchises. So we'll have Tanner throw out a couple franchises and see if I can guess the correct year. First of all, Tanner, why don't you go ahead and map out what the criteria is? What did they use to come up with the most dominant teams for each franchise over the last 50 years?
So the way they do it is they have a formula and they take a bunch of different weighted components. It kind of, when I saw it, it was kind of like a throwback to high school for me. You know how they have like tests count for 30% of your grade, quizzes 20, then you have like 15 homework, 10 in class participation and all that. That's how they do it. So the factors for their formula of how dominant these teams are is regular season win-loss record, which counts for 35% of that weighted average. Also counting for 35% is regular season points per game ratio at 35%. 10% of that weighted average goes to postseason winning percentage. 10% goes to points or postseason points per game ratio, and 10% goes to regular season and postseason point differential versus teams that finish the regular season with winning records.
All right, that's the criteria. All right, what franchise do you want to start with first?
Let's start with the Miami Dolphins.
All right. Won several titles, were real good in the 70s, made it to the Super Bowl in 84 with Marino, had a great offense that year. I think you gotta probably lean towards the obvious answer, probably the 72 Dolphins that went undefeated, the only team to go undefeated and win a Super Bowl. So I'm going to go 72 Dolphins, most dominant team in franchise history.
It is not. It's actually the 73 Dolphins, according to this list. So the year right after.
Okay. All right. Next organization.
How about the Rams? They would have been St. Louis at the time. Now, obviously, L.A., but the Rams.
I'm going to go with the 2001 Rams.
You got it. They were number 11 on the list, the 01 Rams. The 99 Rams were also on the fringe. They were number 26, according to the list. All right, next franchise, the New York Giants.
All right, so again, another organization with multiple Super Bowl championships and Super Bowl appearances. So you've got 86 and 90. They won. They made it. In 2000, they won in 07, they won in 2011, so, those teams were road warriors in 07 and 11, I feel like. Obviously, they beat the undefeated Patriots in 07, some say one of the biggest upsets in Super Bowl history, so you could say that with them being so good on the road and beating the undefeated Patriots in 07, I feel like growing up, I was 10 years old, so I don't remember specifically everything, but my dad was a Giants fan and I was a Redskins fan, so I hated the Giants, and it always seemed like Parcells got the better of Gibbs back in those days. That 86 team was extraordinarily dominant, and they really, I mean, they had a ton of great coaches on there, right? Parcells, they had, Belichick defensively, and they dominated the Broncos in that Super Bowl. Sims almost had a perfect game, passing. Taylor, I remember they totally shut down Carl Mecklenburg defensively for the Broncos. They did a great job of, really nullifying him. And back then, 86, you know, the NFC was, that was a gauntlet to get through. Redskins were good. Eagles were good. The Bears were, you know, coming off of that 85 Bears team. A lot of guys came back. A lot of people thought the Bears should have repeated as champions. So a lot of good teams in the, those mid to late 80s in the NFC. So while the Giants were good and knocked off the Niners in 90 and the Bills, and again, another big upset in the Super Bowl, I'm going to say the 86 Giants team is the most dominant G-men team.
Yep, you got it. They did appear on that top 25 list. Lawrence Taylor was the league's MVP that year. He had 20 and a half sacks during the regular season. And yep, you got it. The 86 Giants. Well, since you mentioned that you were a Washington Redskins fan coming up, how about the Washington Redskins?
Oh, the Redskins, they had some great teams in the 80s and the early 90s. The Redskins and the Giants, Parcells and Gibbs in the 80s in the, there was some slobber knockers in that NFC East. Gibbs led the Redskins to three Super Bowls with three different quarterbacks. 82, it was Theismann with the single bar helmet. Love the single bar helmet on Theismann at quarterback. You had John Riggins, the Diesel. You had the Hogs up front. They beat Don Shula's Dolphins in 82. They had an even better team in 83, but they lost to the LA Raiders. Oh, I hated those Tom Flores and Marcus Allen Raiders, and Marcus just ran all over the Redskins in that Super Bowl. I still remember afterwards President Ronald Reagan calling into the locker room and on the telephone telling Marcus Allen he's a national secret weapon and they're a nuclear weapon, the team, and they're just so good. And I was so mad at Reagan. I mean, I loved Reagan. I mean, I was 8 years old, but I loved Reagan, but that made me really mad. Then you had the 87 Redskins team led by Doug Williams. They went down 10-0, and it looked like Doug had almost broke his leg in the game, but he comes back and they reel off like 42 straight to bury Elway in the Broncos. And then 91, the Mark Rippon led Redskins beat the Bills in Minnesota. I'm going to go with the 82 team.
Nope, it was actually the 91 Redskins. Now, the 83 team does appear on the list also, but the 91 team is up higher. The Buffalo Bills. Let's make that our next team here.
Probably really comes down to those four Super Bowl appearance teams and the four AFC championship teams, 90 to 93. And my guess is, and I'm going to go with the most dominant of all those four teams, you know, you'd think maybe the, it's gotta either be, you would think just statistically, it's either gotta be the 90 team, because they should have won that game against the Giants, or the only other close game they played was that second game against Dallas, not the Leon Lett BB play, but the other one, they were in that game for at least a half. First is the best. I'm going to go 1990 Bills.
It was the 1990 Bills. They did not make the list. They were number 32, but that was the highest Bills team. Two more here. First up, the New England Patriots.
So the Patriots have gone to 9 Super Bowls with Brady and Belichick. They've won 6. They went to the Super Bowl with Parcells in 96, lost to the Packers, went to the Super Bowl in 85, and lost to the Bears. You would think the 07 team, 18-1, they were extraordinarily dominant, Brady and Moss. Team that beat Atlanta was pretty good as well. That was the 2016 team. And those early 2000 teams, the 01 team wasn't that dominant. That was kind of an upset. I'm going to say the 2016 Patriots, the most dominant.
Nope, the most dominant Patriots team was the 07 team. Also making the list were the 2016 and the 04 team.
Okay, all right. Yeah, I should have stuck with 07, with the 18-1. That's what my gut was telling me. All right, last one.
The Pittsburgh Steelers.
Boy. again, a lot of titles there. Steel Curtain, 70s, they dominated. I'm going to go 75 Steelers.
Well, what a leap of faith that was, but you did get it. It was the 75 Steelers.
There you go. So finally, let's end with the top 25.
So at number 25 was the 92 Cowboys. They went 13-3, defeated the Bills 52-17 in the Super Bowl. 24 was the 83 Redskins. They went 14-2, only to lose 38-9 to the Raiders in the Super Bowl. They were only one of 7 teams on this list that did not win a Super Bowl. Number 23 was the 77 Denver Broncos. They went 12-2, lost to the Cowboys 27-10 in the Super Bowl. Number 22, the 94 49ers. They went 13-3, beat the Chargers 49-26 in the Super Bowl. Number 21 is the 71 Dallas Cowboys. They went 11-3, beat the Miami Dolphins 24-3 in the Super Bowl. Number 20 is the 2015 Carolina Panthers, who went 15-1 and then lost 24-10 to Peyton Manning and the Denver Broncos in Super Bowl 50. They were one of only 7 teams to finish 15-1 during the regular season on this list, of course led by league MVP that year Cam Newton. Number 19 is the 1984 Miami Dolphins. They went 14-2, lost to the 49ers 38-16 in the Super Bowl. The 18th team on the list is the 2013 Seattle Seahawks, who went 13-3 and then destroyed the Broncos 43-8 in the Super Bowl. They were one of only 5 teams on the list with more than 2 losses. They were actually, I found this interesting, the first team since the 85 Bears to lead the league in points allowed, yards allowed, and takeaways. Number 17 was the 1986 New York Giants, who went 14-2, defeated the Broncos 39-20 in the Super Bowl. As I mentioned, Lawrence Taylor was the league MVP that year. Number 16 is the 1998 Minnesota Vikings. They went 15-1 and lost 30-27 in overtime to the Falcons in the NFC Championship. Number 15, the 77 Dallas Cowboys. They went 12-2, defeated the Broncos 27-10 in the Super Bowl. Number 14, the 98 Denver Broncos. They went 14-2, beat the Falcons 34-19 in the Super Bowl. They won their first 13 games of the season that year before losing 2 in a row on the road in what would be their only defeats during John Elway's final NFL season. Number 13, the 96 Green Bay Packers, who went 13-3. They defeated the Patriots 35-21 in the Super Bowl. They had the top-ranked scoring offense and defense that season. Number 12, the 2004 New England Patriots. They went 14-2, beat Donovan McNabb and the Philadelphia Eagles 24-21 in the Super Bowl. No team since 1970 owns more total victories than the 2004 Patriots against teams that finished the regular season with winning records. They went 10-1 in those games with a plus 113 point differential in those games.
Wow.
Number 11, the 2001 Rams, who went 14-2, lost to the Patriots 20-17 in the Super Bowl. Number 10, the 2016 New England Patriots, 14-2, beat the Falcons 34-28 in the Super Bowl. They lost just one game, 31-24 at home to Seattle after Tom Brady returned from a four-game suspension to start the season. And then, of course, we all know with that team, they overcame the 28-3 deficit in the Super Bowl, beating an Atlanta Falcons team that boasted the NFL's number one offense. At number nine, we have the 89 San Francisco 49ers, went 14-2, defeated the Broncos 55-10 in the Super Bowl. Number eight is the 78 Steelers, went 14-2, beat the Cowboys 35-31 in the Super Bowl. They were led by league MVP Terry Bradshaw, who set Super Bowl records at the time with 318 yards and four touchdowns in that win over the Cowboys. Number seven, we got back-to-back Steeler teams. It's the 75 Steelers. They went 12-2. They defeated the Cowboys 21-17 in the Super Bowl, and that was just a phenomenal defense. They held opponents to 10 or fewer points in 10 games, including a pair of playoff victories,
wow,
and finished in the top five in points allowed, interceptions, and sacks, among other categories. Number six, the 07 New England Patriots, 16-0, and then lost 17-14 to the Giants in the Super Bowl because our local connections, they just started balling out. David Tyree, obviously, the helmet catch, and then that Mike Waffle coach defensive line really got after Tom Brady. This was the highest-ranked team on the list that did not win at all. They averaged 36.8 points per game during the regular season and won by an average of 19.7 points per game during that 16-0 run. They had a 9-1 record against winning teams. The only loss was the Giants in the Super Bowl and a plus 152 point differential in those games, which is a margin that has only been topped by three teams since 1970. Number five is the 72 Dolphins, undefeated, 14-0, defeated the Redskins 14-7 in the Super Bowl. Now, you might think this is a little controversial to have the 73 Dolphins. Spoiler, they're number four on the list, while the 72 Dolphins are five. The reason that the 73 Dolphins are ahead of the 72 Dolphins is because they were far more dominant than the 72 Dolphins during the playoffs. They had an average margin of victory of 17.3 points per game, and they were also more dominant than the 72 Dolphins in terms of their record against teams that finished with winning records. Counting the playoffs, the 73 Dolphins went 8-1 against winning teams compared to 5-0 with the 72 Dolphins. The 72 Dolphins, they just didn't really play that great of competition. You can only play the teams that are on your schedule, but that is what puts the 73 Dolphins at number four, who went 12-2. They beat the Vikings 24-7 in the Super Bowl. Number three, the 91 Redskins, who went 14-2, defeated the Bills 37-24 in the Super Bowl. They had the top ranked offense and number two defense that season. Number two is the 84 49ers, who went 15-1, beat the Dolphins 38-16 in the Super Bowl. You know, those Bill Walsh era 49ers were known for their innovative offenses, but they also fielded some pretty dominant defenses during this era. Like this team, for example, they ranked second in points scored and first in points allowed during the regular season. They shut out the ascending Chicago Bears 23-0 in the NFC Championship game. And then in the Super Bowl, they held Dan Marino's Dolphins to a season low 16 points. And Marino was red hot this year. He had thrown a league record at the time, 48 touchdown passes. He was named the league's MVP, but the 49ers held Miami to 6 points over the final three quarters of that Super Bowl. They picked off Marino twice, sacked him four times. And number one, the 85 Chicago Bears, who went 15-1. Absolutely mollywhopped the Patriots 46-10 in the Super Bowl. And they scored 9.1 times as many points as their playoff opponents, which was by far the largest ratio for any playoff team since 1970. And even though I wasn't alive back then, it still disappoints me how Walter Payton didn't get a touchdown in that game. But there you have it. The 85 Bears, the most dominant team in the past 50 years.
Just listening to that list, I'm going to guess franchises with the most on that list, top 25, has to probably be the Patriots, correct?
Yep, the Patriots have three, and they're tied with a couple other teams. Dolphins were tied with the Patriots with three, 72, 73, and 84. The 49ers, 84, 89, and 94. Steelers only had two, 75, 78.
So what was the reasoning behind the Bills being at 32nd and not higher or in the top 25?
Well, they generally fared more poorly in point differential against winning teams. The 1990 version was plus 51 in that point differential category, which was the best for any Bills playoff team since 1970. And even then, nearly all of that differential came by way of a 51-3 demolishing of the Raiders in the AFC Championship game. And altogether, those Bills Super Bowl teams were 32-20 against winning teams with a 1.6 point differential against those teams. So, you know, while you might think back and think that those teams were dominant, you know, making it to four straight Super Bowls, you know, once you kind of you look at those numbers, then, you know, you start to think they weren't as dominant as maybe you recall. So, you know, they really weren't all that great against, you know, plus 500 teams, and I did them in here on this list.
All righty, we got to take a break here so we can get to Dallas Braden on and talk a little baseball with him, his time with the Hornell Dodgers, his time with the Oakland A's as a starting pitcher, his perfect game in 2010, and the state of baseball right now in the negotiations, and if there will be a season. Tanner, right now, as you check Twitter and the internet, what is it saying? Where do we stand right now? Who has the ball in their court as far as the negotiation with the owners and the players union?
So the last offer has been submitted from the MLBPA to the MLB. It was the offer consisted of a 70-game season from July 19th through September 30th. It would be full prorated pay. Spring training would begin in a couple days here, June 26th to June 28th. There would be expanded playoffs to 16 teams in 2020 and 2021. There would be a 50-50 split of incremental TV revenue for any additional postseason games in 2021. And that was immediately rejected by the commissioner. So we're still at a standstill here.
All right, go ahead and ask that trivia question.
Who is the first baseball player to appear on a box of Wheaties? Lou Gehrig, Mel Ott, Babe Ruth, or Joe DiMaggio?
All righty, let's take a break. We'll be back. Dallas Braden on the other side after this.
I'm singing lightly, you know I don't want much. I even love handmade crafts made of macaroni. Come on now, you should know me. All I need is tasty craft beer, please. Sometimes I might eat too much. No worry about my weight, got the dad bod rocking on me. Sketch on my feet, cargo shorts look good on me. I'm a dad, that's what I do. I get the groceries when I'm asked to. The hair on my head's getting thin, that's true, but I got lots on my body. Me and your mom said clean your room, but I'll probably forget about it real, real soon. You can find me with a beer by the barbecue. I'm a dad, that's what I do. I'm a dad, that's what I do. You can find me with a beer by the barbecue. I'm a dad, that's what I do.
If you have put off health testing or procedures because of COVID-19, Jones Memorial Hospital would like you to know it's safe to come back. The extra safety measures at Jones include health screening and masking for all, appointments for outpatient services, reconfigured waiting areas, and COVID-19 testing for all surgical patients and all inpatients. It's time to get your health care back on track. It's safe to come to Jones Memorial.
Pennington, he's got it. Throw to first. He did it. He did it. Dallas Braden has thrown a perfect game. Holy cow, he did it.
Two out, nobody on, ninth inning. And Braden turns, he throws, and it's swung on a ground ball to short. Taken there, Pennington's got it. He throws a perfect game. Dallas Braden has thrown a perfect game. The A's have beaten Tampa Bay 4-0. The kid from Stockton has done it for the A's.
Tough on an
umpire, too. He knows what's going on.
3-1 pitch. Swing and a ground ball to short. Picked up by Pennington and the throw to first. He did it. Braden has thrown a perfect game. And the 26-year-old Oakland left-hander, Dallas Braden, has thrown a perfect game here. 27 up and 27 down.
3-1 pitch. Swing and a ground ball towards short. This could do it. Shortstop Pennington has it. His throw across in time. And Dallas Braden has thrown a perfect game on this Mother's Day 2010. A young man who lost his mother at a very young age has thrown a perfect game here in Oakland, California.
You ain't got nothing to say. It was perfect.
Ladies and gentlemen, here's tonight's top 10 list. Let's go. It's a good category. Top 10 thoughts that went through Dallas Braden's mind while he threw his perfect game. You know about this, Paul?
Yes, I
do. Oakland Athletics defeated the Tampa Bay Rays 4-0. It was Dallas Braden's 18th win of his career, and I believe only the 19th in history of Major League Baseball, only the 19th perfect game.
Fantastic.
This is what they call a no-no. So here now we have a collection of thoughts that went through Dallas Braden's mind. And ladies and gentlemen, presenting tonight's top 10 list, please welcome from your Oakland Athletics, Dallas Braden, ladies and gentlemen. What's the deal with you and A-Rod? What happened there? You ran on his mound? He ran on your mound or something?
Yeah, just a slight misunderstanding as far as some of the unwritten rules that we've kind of put on the back burner. It's been taken care of.
Yeah. Oh, it has been taken care of.
Sure.
Come on. Let's heat it up a little. Dallas, now I notice you wear the bill of your hat flat. Now, why is that?
So my peripheral vision can give me an advantage. You know, I don't know that it really helps at all. I'm just a weirdo, I guess. Good.
Here we go. Number 10.
Grandma's right. Stick it, A-Rod.
Yeah, there you go. Good for Grandma. Number 9.
I did it. Oh, crap, it's only the fourth inning.
Whoops. Number 8.
Seriously, how cool a name is Dallas Braden?
Yeah, you're right about that. Number 7.
Now maybe Justin Bieber will notice me.
Oh, let's keep our fingers crossed. Number 6.
I must not tell the world I'm Iron Man.
Right.
What? Wait a minute. Did he just say he's Iron Man?
Get out of the way.
Number 5.
This is something they can never take away from me. But for $50,000, you can have my glove.
All right. Number 4.
This next pitch, eyes closed.
Okay. Ah. Number 3.
Even I've never heard of me.
What? Now, wait a minute. That's not possible. Number 2.
I should at least give up one hit so I don't have to do Letterman.
Hey, wait a minute. Hey, I heard that. And the number 1 thought that went through Dallas Braden's mind while he's throwing his perfect game.
Maybe I can give Kate Hudson a call.
Yeah, maybe you can. Attaboy, Dallas Braden, ladies and gentlemen.
Huge. He's huge. I mean, seriously, literally the greatest to ever live. The guy is amazing.
The Joel Oriend Show.
This isn't the WWE. You know, in this sport, this is real fighting.
On 92.1 The Team.
Excited to have our next guest on. He pitched for the Oakland A's. He appeared in 94 games, 491 innings, 305 strikeouts, 79 starts under his belt, won 26 games with an ERA of 4.16. He had 4 pitches, the cutter, the fastball, the changeup, and the slurve ball. May 9th, 2010 at home, threw the perfect game. You just heard the montage of that. It was the 19th in Major League Baseball history. Cannot believe it's been 10 years already since Dallas Braden's perfect game. He is one of the most famous and successful Hornell Dodgers. He played for the Dodgers in 2003. He ranks right up there with Tim Hudson, Rajah Davis, Maury Wills, Don Zimmer, Jason Kinney, and Brett Carroll. Let's bring him on. He also does a podcast for Barstool Sports, The Starting Nine. It's Dallas Braden. Dallas, you know, I don't know if it gets old, having to hear all those highlights and people talking to you about the perfect game. Obviously, your career was more than just that one start, but you probably get asked about that perfect game almost daily.
You know, it's one of those things, and I love being able to kind of frame it this way. It is the gift that keeps on giving because, as you kind of said, I get to speak to somebody virtually every day that notices me or really more often notices my grandmother, and they're like, oh, that's that lady I love because she was the one yelling at A-Rod. She was the one standing on the top of the dugout. She like, you know, she's a superstar. So I get to hear those stories and I get to feel that emotion and share that with people who were, maybe they were watching the game or they weren't where they should have been because they were watching the game or, you know, like they were late to the barbecue. A lot of times what's really cool is I get to hear both sides of that story because I'm with somebody who should have been at the barbecue and I'm with the person who was at the barbecue that they were waiting on, right? And they didn't show up because there's this baseball game going on. And, you know, little did they know we would all be together at some point later down the line and get to share that story together. And I get that kind of stuff happens to me almost every day. So it is the coolest thing. It's the coolest thing ever.
Now, I don't know how deep you had gone in a game before with a no-no and perfect game, but was there a point in time in the game where you say, oh boy, I've got a no-no going here, a perfect game. Did the teammates start leaving you alone in the dugout? Did you start feeling all by yourself? Was there one point in time where you started to get a little bit of a pucker factor where you started to get a little nervous because you were getting close to a perfect game?
No, you know, I always felt like I was never a guy who could take myself as seriously on the days in between as I do on my start day. So on my start day, I was, you know, head down, hoodie on. I didn't speak to anybody and nobody really spoke to me. And I just stayed out of people's way and they stayed out of my way in the clubhouse. And that was how I was every time I started. So there was never a moment on that day that was really different in that regard, as far as my teammates, you know, kind of leaving me alone in the dugout around the fifth inning or sixth. Like there was really none of that. You know, as far as me kind of noticing when or having an idea, we were playing the Tampa Bay Rays, and at that time, you know, it's still early in the season, but they're at that point establishing themselves as a really good team. They're a really good offense. They're, you know, they got some good veteran pitchers. James Shields was one of them, and he was the guy on the mound that day. And so when there's a mound meeting, I'm kind of looking up at the scoreboard and I'm realizing, all right, we've kind of put together, you know, we put together a couple runs here against him. Oh, wow. I don't think I've given, well, it says I haven't given up a hit. I don't think I've given up a walk either. And then I can remember, you know, audibly saying to myself, don't baby this. Like, oh God, don't baby this. Don't blow this. Like, you don't even deserve to be here right now. So just don't blow this. All right. And then that's kind of when it all started to click and I all started to realize. And from there, it was just a matter of, you know, the ball finding the defender.
So right out of high school, you get drafted by the Braves in the 45th round in 2001, but you did not sign. You decided to go to college and you pitched at American River College in Sacramento. You went 12-4 with a one hit complete game and 14 strikeouts in one start for American River College. That's obviously how and when you came to Hornell during your time at American River College to play for the Dodgers. Then you got drafted in 2004 in the 24th round by the A's. So obviously your stock had risen going to college. You really did show the scouts something because you went from the 45th round to the 24th round with the A's. So you just felt, I guess, you weren't quite ready yet right out of high school to sign and go into the minors with the Braves?
Yeah, I got drafted out of high school, but I was, I was about two shades over the neat cap of a grasshopper, and I was about 40 pounds soaking wet in a cotton uniform on my best day as a senior in high school. So I needed to physically grow. And I needed to mentally grow as well. Mm-hmm. You know, I just lost my mom my senior year in high school, so I needed to process that, and I had no idea how long that was going to take.
Right.
So I didn't know that playing professional baseball at that moment in time was obviously a dream,
a dream realized getting drafted, but if it was going to be a dream fulfilled, you know, I needed to be smart about it.
What do you miss most about being in this area in upstate New York?
Yeah, what's really cool is I remember just how close in proximity the fans were and how close just like the family sort of environment, because there were kids running around on the field and like it was just a you got the sense that this was like a summer night that people looked forward to. Mm-hmm. And that was really special, because I didn't get to go play, you know, in the Cape Cod League with all the prospects or whatnot, because maybe I wasn't taking care of business the way I should have been. But when you get to upstate New York and you take in the beauty of the area, and then you stop and have conversations with people who love the game, who love the town they live in and love the opportunity they have to maybe house a ball player, show up to the ballpark every night and watch their team play, or maybe it's take a drive a couple hours and watch their team play because it's not far. That's the sense, just the neighborhood baseball feel. And maybe this is me now living in L.A., but like being able to walk outside and take a big, deep breath of fresh air, that means a lot to me. Sure. And I think I remember that. Yep. I miss stuff like that. That's just not something that's available readily out here in this neck of the woods.
Yep.
But when I go back to that summer, I just think about how much fun I had traveling along, riding in our vans, playing, going to Alfred and I think Wayne County.
Yep.
And just being able to kind of cruise a beautiful countryside and play baseball was an experience, you know, that I was living in real time that I hadn't had before. And that was an amazing feel.
So after you retired in 2014, you got into broadcasting. You started out with ESPN as an in-studio analyst on Baseball Tonight. You replaced Kurt Schilling in the booth as color analyst for Monday Night Baseball. You now are the color analyst on NBC Sports California for Oakland A's games. The transition has been easier for some than others. Sometimes people seem to like the athlete who comes into the booth and speaks openly and frankly and criticizes his former team or coach or teammates, like Barkley. People, for some reason, love to be ripped by Barkley, Charles Barkley. It's like a badge of honor. Where's the balance for you, Dallas, where you want to be honest because you want to have that respect and legitimacy with the audience, but you also don't want to alienate all of the players, because then when you go down on the field, if they've heard what you've been saying and criticizing them and ripping them on the broadcast, they're not going to want to talk to you, and, you know, they're not going to be very welcoming down on the field or in the clubhouse. How have you dealt with that balance of being a former player and now having to be in the booth and be a little honest and point mistakes out and maybe be a little hard on guys that you're friends with?
Well, I think one of the things that I try to do, and this is the most important thing in my opinion, is being available and being able to be held accountable for your opinion. You know, because if we're being honest, you probably like your opinion a lot, more times than not. You know, that's kind of how those things work. But that doesn't mean you're always right. That doesn't mean you're right even half the time. And just because you have an opinion that people are listening to, or in some instances, people feel like they're being forced to listen to, you know, because not everybody's your friend or your fan, you have a responsibility, and that's to answer to someone who you are criticizing, who at that very moment can't defend themselves. So the next day during BP, you got to be down on the field. You got to be around there for conversation, like, hey, man, you know, I caught wind about you talking about this, or, you know, I'm lagging here. Well, you might get some inside information. You might get the here's why. And then from there, it's up to you to make sure that the fans who don't have the ability that you do, who don't have the luxury of coming face-to-face with their favorite player, now it's up to you to make sure that fan understands just what that ball player is going through. But then your responsibility is to do it in a fashion where the ball player can trust you. They know that you're going to call it straight. And you know what? I've always said this. If you're looking for someone to tell you that they're not a homer, they don't love their team, well, I'm not the announcer for you. I'm not that guy. I love the Oakland A's. I love my team. But I love the competitors. I love the guys on the other side in the other dugout, too. And they're really good at baseball. And our fans deserve to know about them as well. And so I take it as a really big responsibility to make sure the fans appreciate who they're watching, appreciate what they're watching, and then if I can, just sort of provide some context as to why they're seeing what they're seeing.
Yeah, so again, while we're on the topic of kind of this podcasting, and I know you got into broadcasting a little bit after your playing career, and we've had a couple former athletes on this show who have gone into broadcasting after their playing careers, and I always ask them if it was something that they always wanted to do after their playing career, or if it was just a spur-of-the-moment type thing. So I will extend that same question to you. Was broadcasting and, you know, podcasting always something you wanted to do after your playing career was over, or was it something that you were just approached with the opportunity and just ran with it?
Yeah, it's way more of the latter. I was provided with the opportunity at ESPN. You know, I was on my fishing boat and answered a phone call if I wanted to go and audition to be on Baseball Tonight and whatever. And so I was like, sure, sounds great. So I went out there, you know, spent the day meeting with, you know, all the important people, I guess. And, you know, by the time I left the campus, I had a contract offer. You know, a month later, I had a contract extension. And, like, it was just kind of laid out for me, like, okay, this is a very real avenue to take, you know? And it was like, yeah, I was on a random Tuesday. I get a phone call. And then, you know, by first pitch that season, I'm now working on a national broadcast. And that was really cool. And understanding that this has kind of been a seamless transition for me, it's almost like, yeah, I guess I never really knew that I wanted to do this, but I've had so much fun because of the folks I get to work with, the things I've learned about the game on different levels from different perspectives. It's something I don't know that happens if I'm still just hanging out on the fishing boat, you know?
On the phone with us, Dallas Braden, former Major League Baseball pitcher with the Oakland A's. He pitched for the Hornell Dodgers in 2003. All right, Dallas. Let's do a couple quick hitters here, a couple fastballs. Let me throw a couple fastballs at you and see if you can catch up to these and hit these. Let's test your memory, okay? You get pulled up to the big club for the Oakland A's in 2007. Which starting pitcher in the rotation got injured and was the reason you got called up?
Let's see. I believe, well, I made my first start against the Orioles. Was it Joe Kennedy?
Rich Harden.
Yeah,
all right. So next, your opening day pitcher, 2009 for the Oakland A's. Who do you throw against?
Oh man. Oh dang. Was it Weaver?
Well, I'll give you credit. You actually going a little deeper than what I was asking for and expecting. Did a little extra credit on this one. I was just looking for the team you faced that day, opening day 2009, Los Angeles Angels of Anaheim. At Anaheim, you guys came up short that day, 3-2-0. So it was the Angels. I'm not sure who the pitcher
was.
Yeah.
Okay. So I knew it was. I know it was Anaheim. I just didn't know the actual starting pitcher. That's why I'm saying Weaver. So, the Angels.
Perfect game, Mother's Day 2010. Who's your battery mate that day? Who's your catcher?
Oh, yeah, Landeskog.
Yep, that's right. You got it. So you throw the 19th perfect game in Major League Baseball history. Who threw the 18th? Who was the last to throw a perfect game before you?
Mark Burley.
Yes, correct. Okay, you threw the 19th perfect game in Major League Baseball history. Who threw the 20th? Who was the first person after you to throw a perfect game?
Roy Halladay.
You got it. Doc Halladay. There's only been four guys who have accomplished that feat in the last 10 years since you. Roy Halladay, Philip Humber, Matt Cain, and Felix Hernandez. Now, even though it hasn't been that long, Dallas, since you were in the league and you were a starting pitcher, but things have changed a lot since you've been in the league. There's more pitch counts, pitch limits, certain rules that some clubs have on pitchers, like the Jabba rules and the Steven Strasburg rules. You were the pitcher of the year for the A's organization in 2005 when you were in the minor league system for them. You get brought up, and in 07, you throw 71 innings. Then the next year, you throw 72. Then you throw 136. Then you throw 192. You had already had a shoulder surgery while you were in the minors. You then have to have two or three while you're up with the big club, and eventually your shoulder just gets shredded. Is there any thoughts or regrets that maybe they didn't bring you along a little slower and pace you, and that maybe they gave you too many innings too fast, and that was really detrimental to your shoulder?
No, there's nothing I could possibly regret. I think if you even for a minute in this lifetime spend a moment negatively looking in your rearview mirror and wishing you would have taken a different exit or taken a different turn, you're really not doing yourself any favor, and you're really not setting yourself up to enjoy the journey that's ahead of you, because you're consistently looking back wondering what you could do to change things that you just can't change. And I have been afforded such a beautiful opportunity to live life based on what the game of baseball has given me. And for me to spend one moment reflecting negatively or questioning what if, I couldn't imagine what that would do to my psyche. I couldn't imagine living a life where I don't appreciate what I have. Like, you're calling me right now to hang out and talk, and that's the case because I had one good day of work, and on my way to having that one good day of work, I got to hang out in Hornell and have an experience of a lifetime. And how can I ever think about changing that kind of trajectory?
All right, how about this one? Best tough guy moment for a pitcher. Nolan Ryan pummeling Robin Ventura when Robin charged the mound, Roger Clemens throwing the bat at Mike Piazza, or you screaming at A-Rod after just being in the league for two or three years when he ran across the mound breaking one of the unwritten rules, and you going after someone who had already won a World Series and some believe one of the greatest to play at least at his position.
Yeah, you know what? Obviously, I've got to tip my hat to the man, to Nolan Ryan. No doubt about that. We didn't have the opportunity to get physical, me and A-Rod, and that is not a. I'm not saying that I'm gonna come out on top in that exchange. I'm just saying we could have danced, absolutely. I'm not afraid to take one on the chin. I'm not afraid to take three or four on the chin. I don't care. But that didn't happen. So Nolan Ryan grabbing a young Robin Ventura who probably would think differently having the opportunity to jump in a hot tub time machine and go back and do that over again. He might take a different route.
On the phone with us, podcast host of The Starting Nine and former Hornell Dodger pitcher and former major league pitcher for the Oakland A's from 2007 to 2014, Dallas Braden. Okay, Dallas, give me your thoughts on what's going on with this negotiation between the owners and the players union. I know it's going back and forth. Where does it stand, and what are your thoughts on this back and forth? Will there be baseball in 2020?
Well, I think we're getting there. We're getting very close, without diving too deep into the legal ramifications and what is, legally at the disposal of the players union. Right now, if we're talking about receiving the full amount of money that we talked about, and we're also talking about playing a sufficient amount of games, really, that's what you've been after this entire time. And however unfortunate it may be that it's taken this long to get here, that's all going to, I don't want to say be forgotten, but that is all going to take a back seat to baseball ramping up and watching it develop. So as far as what I would do right now, we're doing it, and this is what it should have been done a long time ago. But I said at the very beginning, if there was ever an issue with the language in the contract and that really wanting to be figured out, then we should have gone to an independent arbiter And that should have been settled just like every other money issue in the game is settled. You know, like when players go to arbitration and they say, I deserve this much. And the team says, no, you deserve this much. Well, we can't agree. So guess what? We're going to go to an arbitrator and they will determine who's right here. So that should have been done when the owners felt like they had the ability to circle back and negotiate because fans were no longer going to be allowed in. Well, the players didn't agree because the language wasn't right. And so if you've got two sides disagreeing, let's settle that early. But that was never the intention from one side. It was always about trying to knock down the amount of games. It was never about trying to get baseball to the fans as quickly and safely as possible. And that's unfortunate. But hopefully that is not going to be the storyline moving forward. Hopefully we'll have baseball to be able to put this kind of fiasco behind us.
Now, Dallas, you seem to be an old school guy, a traditionalist. You don't mind mixing it up a little bit. You're a dirt dog. You're a blue collar kind of guy. So this whole sign stealing thing, you know, it always seemed to be a part of the game, the cat and mouse, when a guy's on second trying to pick up the signs and the pitcher and the catcher have to come together and change up their signs. But it got really sophisticated, and, you know, back in the day, it just seemed like the players would have self-policed themselves. Were you surprised that it had to go up the chain to the commissioner and that the players didn't just take care of it themselves?
Yeah, and I think, and this might be very old school, but I feel like, I think it's a matter of being able to identify what's going on. Identifying that you are currently being victimized so that you can take a stance in real time. That's what it would take, right? So when you think about Danny Farquhar stepping off the mound, calling out the pitcher, calling out his catcher because he hears what's going on in real time, like it would take that moment for something like that to happen. Maybe Farquhar puts one in the ribcage of somebody and his catcher let him know, hey, this one you're about to sew on and wear. Why? Because we know what's going on. We hear what's happening. So you better go back in there and tell those boys to quit banging on whatever they're banging on or quit whistling. Otherwise, you're going to sew one on and the guy behind you is going to sew one on. And we're just going to keep this train moving until finally the game is called and they ask why. And then the entire world knows. So we'll give you this opportunity, right? Well, that never happened. And I feel like if that would have happened, then maybe we don't know as much as we know about what we know about.
All right. Before we let you go, can you give us one for the team? Your famous home run call that you use on NBC Sports California when the A's go yard in a baseball game.
No doubt about it. Are you ready? You boys got your bags packed?
Yep.
All aboard. Next stop, Pound Town.
Nice. Thank you so much, Dallas. It was fun catching up with you. Continued success and health for you and your family. And hopefully we can get you on once maybe a baseball season starts and chat about that.
Thank you, guys. Stay safe. And hopefully we're all enjoying the ball game very soon.
All right, there you go. Dallas Braden, former Hornell Dodger. He played for the Dodgers in 2003. He then got drafted by the Oakland A's in 2004. He was the pitcher of the year for the Oakland A's organization in 2005. Came up to the big club in 2007 and threw the perfect game on Mother's Day in 2010. 10 years ago already. He now does work for NBC Sports California. He hosts a podcast with Jared Carabas on Barstool Sports, The Starting Nine, and he also has a radio show on Sirius XM. Dallas Braden. Very cool. That's neat to catch up with a former Hornell Dodger, one of the greats. Let's take a break. We'll be back.
Some dads are sports fans, they'll take you to baseball. Some dads would rather send mom. Some dads will see you cry and tell you that it's okay. Some dads will tell you man up. And though there's many kinds, some with manly pride, some with hair inside of their ears and nose. Oh, I can see now. I can see now most dads, they just even more. Socks and sandals don't look bad on him, but they do.
Now's the time. Environmental Wood Products of Hornell is offering a different sale on kitchen or bathroom cabinets each month. This month, till July, Waypoint is offering customers their choice of a free corner or sink face cabinet in all series with a 12-plus cabinet order, free kitchen or bath design, and free delivery to your home. Environmental Wood Products is located on Stewart Road in Hornell. Phone 607-324-6127, 324-6127.
It's the Joel Oriend Show.
Hello!
On 92.1 The Team.
Alrighty, hello means goodbye. We got a Boot Scoot Boogie on out of here. But before we do, Tanner, why don't you go ahead one more time and tell the audience how they can enter to win a friendly four-pack of tickets to see Fuel and Lit.
The person that can guess my 40-yard dash time the closest without going over will win the tickets, and you can email your guesses to 921theteam@gmail.com. You can text them to the Oriend listener line, 607-363-TEAM, and whoever comes the closest without going over will have themselves four tickets to see Fuel and Lit August 29th at the Tags Summer Stage in Big Flats.
Okay, one more time, that trivia question.
Who was the first baseball player to grace a box of Wheaties? Lou Gehrig, Mel Ott, Babe Ruth, or Joe DiMaggio?
I'm going to go with, I feel like it's not one of the most obvious ones, and that's the trick. Yeah, I'm going to go Mel Ott.
It's actually Lou Gehrig. In 1934, not only did Gehrig win the Triple Crown batting title, he became the first baseball player to appear on a box of Wheaties, although, in fairness, he appeared on the back and not the front.
Oh, gotcha. All right, very good. Very interesting. Okay, why don't we do Today in Sports History?
Today in 1950, Joe DiMaggio recorded his 2000th hit as the Yankees beat the Indians 8-2. In 1982, Pete Rose became the fifth MLB player to appear in 3,000 career games. In 1986, Jim Fregosi replaced Tony La Russa as manager of the White Sox. In 1993, the Chicago Bulls defeated the Phoenix Suns in Game 6, winning the NBA Finals 4-2 after Michael Jordan averaged a finals record 41 points per game. The Bulls became the first team since the Celtics of the 60s to three-peat, and Jordan became the first player in NBA history to win three straight finals MVPs. In 1994, former NFL running back O.J. Simpson was arraigned on the murder of Nicole Brown Simpson and Ron Goldman. In 2006, the Miami Heat beat the Dallas Mavericks in Game 6, clinching an NBA Finals victory 4-2, becoming the third team in NBA history to win the finals after trailing 0-2 in the series. Dwayne Wade was named Finals MVP. In 2013, the Miami Heat beat the San Antonio Spurs in Game 7, winning the NBA Finals 4-3. LeBron James was named Finals MVP for the second straight year. In 2017, Tiger Woods checked into a clinic to manage his pain medication and sleep disorder following an arrest for driving under the influence. And on this day in 2019, Duke power forward Zion Williamson was named the first overall pick in the NBA draft by the New Orleans Pelicans. Taking a look at birthdays today, born in 1980 in Linwood, California, Venus Williams, the American tennis star considered one of the all-time greats of women's tennis. In 1983, a Super Bowl champion running back, three-time Pro Bowler, two-time member of the first team All-Pro, former Charger, Saint, and Eagle, it's Darren Sproles. Born on this day in 1985, the man who was once drafted number two overall ahead of Dwayne Wade, Carmelo Anthony, and Chris Bosh in the 2003 NBA draft by the Detroit Pistons, Darko Milicic. In 1990, former Big East Defensive Player of the Year as a member of the Syracuse Orange, who played for the Boston Celtics as well as a handful of NBA D-League teams, where he set the D-League record for shots blocked in a game with 14. It's the late Fab Melo, rest in peace. And born on this day in 1994, former Pro Bowl defensive lineman who now plays for the New York Giants, Leonard Williams. And that is today in sports history.
All righty, there you go. Thanks so much, Tanner. Enjoy your weekend. Enjoy your day with your pops. And we'll talk with you next weekend, all right?
All right, same to you.
All righty, I want to thank our guests, two-time NBA champion Greg Kite, winning titles in 84 and 86 with the Boston Celtics. He also played for the Clippers, the Hornets, the Magic, the Pacers, and the Knicks, and Dallas Braden, former Hornell Dodger pitcher. He was here in Hornell pitching for the Dodgers in 2003. He then got drafted by the Oakland A's. He pitched for the A's from 2007 to 2014, winning 26 games. He threw a perfect game on Mother's Day in 2010. He now has his own podcast with Jared Carabas on Barstool Sports, The Starting Nine, and he does work for NBC Sports California doing Oakland A's games on TV. Have yourself a wonderful Father's Day. I hope you can spend it with your family, whether it be virtually using Zoom or Skype or FaceTime or in person. Be good, everybody. If not, have fun trying. I'll catch you on the flip side. I'm gone.
First person voted out a survivor. That's six. That's enough. Need to grab your torch. The tribe has spoken.
Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes today's broadcast. Thank you for listening to my son, because without you listening, he would still be living at home.
You suck.
Transfer complete.